insurance protect farmers against losses such as flood, fire, and crop failure. It acts as a tool to help farmers manage their yields and prices. Let's have a conversation on the back of this with the general manager of Ghana's Agricultural Insurance Pool. He's in the person of Aladi Ali Muhammad Cage. My name is Elinam, and this is Ghanaian Farmer on Joy Prime. Watch it every Monday 2:30, and the repeat is on Thursdays at 10 p.m. This program is proudly brought to you by Lizzie Tomato Mix. Also, make a date with us in our upcoming conference on the 26th of this month. We are highlighting on the challenges and solutions of farmers here in Ghana. Now, going for a quick break, and when I come back, Aladi tells me all about this institution and what benefits farmers stand to gain to becoming a part of it. Stay tuned, I'll be right back after this. Thanks for staying with us. If you just tune in, you're watching the Ghanaian Farmer on Joy Prime. My name is Enlighten, and my guest today is Aladi Ali Muhammad Ketu. Aladi, thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Okay. We are glad you opened your doors for us to have a conversation with you. Now, to begin with, in your profile states you've been in existence for the past 10 years. However, only a handful of people know about Ghana's Agriculture Insurance Pool. Am I correct?
Yes, you are correct. Ghana Insurance Pool was formed to provide a missing link in the agriculture value chain. You know, in any business, we have insurance, every step you take in insurance, but when it comes to agriculture, there was no insurance for the primary producer, which we refer to as a farmer. So that was the missing link. So that's why the idea was created by the National Insurance Commission and then the GIZ. That's a joint partner. And then the Ghana Insurance Association. Then the pool was formed to provide that missing link. So we were formed to provide innovative and sustainable agriculture insurance products for all manners of farmers. And it's not only for crop farmers, but it cuts across. The scope is for crop, forestry, livestock, and aquaculture. So these are the areas. But yes, you are right that we are not being heard enough. Yes, agriculture insurance has been silent or a bit silent because we started in the north and we wanted to work in such a way that the farmers who benefit from it will know the importance of it and they will carry the tops of it. That's the strategy we adapted. That's how come most farmers don't know of us. But now we are changing the narrative. We have an institution in the insurance industry called the National Insurance Awareness Communicated Group, which the National Insurance Commission signed MOU with them recently for them to promote agriculture insurance. So very soon, issues on agriculture insurance will come on board as they do for other insurance programs. Then we also do participate. I remember there was a program, Insurance and You, which Joy FM was hosting. And I participated in one of those programs. So yes, we are making efforts to get to the farmers and the group that have benefited from it.
Right, I see. Are you the only agriculture insurance company right now as we speak in Ghana?
Yes, we can say that because as the name suggests, it's a pool. So a pool of 17 non-life insurance companies.
Okay.
So we are representing a pool of insurance companies,
right,
with Collard Insurance as the lead insurer. Then we have president of the GIA, Ghana Insurance Association, as a board chair.
Right.
Then there's even a steering committee, which comprises of the National Insurance Commission, Ghana Insurance Association, developed partners, financial institutions, and that is chaired by the Commissioner of Insurance himself. So that is how it's structured.
Majority of farmers in Ghana are smallholder farmers. Do you have a method of tracking their investment and how do you get them to join the insurance pool?
Thank you very much. That is not strange to farming because when you look at agriculture in sub-Saharan Africa, it's dominated by smallholder farmers. Okay. And Ghana is not an exception. About 95% of the farmers are smallholder farmers and they produce the food we eat. normally the commercial guys are more interested in processing and export. So they look at the export market. But the food you see on our roadside and all that are for the smallholder farmers. So in aquaculture insurance, yes, if you have a potential of 95% of the farming population in the sector, you cannot neglect them. So we normally have different products for different categories of farmers. We have the indemnity-based product, that's the normal insurance for the commercial farmers. That involves visiting the farm, asking for data, and a whole lot of things. Then we have the smallholder farmers who are far and scattered. And because we cannot travel to see them visit and know whatever they are doing, we have what you call globally as index-based insurance products. And the index-based insurance products, we have two of them in our portfolio. One is weather index insurance, which we probably call drought index insurance. And since we cannot visit the farmers, what this does is that we set up a proxy where we can use to measure, and the proxy should have a correlation with the geography of the farmers. So the farmers in a particular group could be insured under that scheme. For example, let's say we have a farmers in the community who live close by a weather station. So we are going to see how the rainfall will affect the yield. And we use the data from the weather station to determine whether there's drought or no drought. So in this situation, if at the end of the day, the data from the weather station indicates that there was a shortfall of the volume of water the plant need, then this has been linked when the product was designed so that if the shortfall is about 20%, 20% of the sum insured is paid. I will explain that if the shortfall is about 50%, then 50% of the sum insured. The sum insured simply means the total exposure of the farmer. I mean, normally for smallholder farmers, we use their crop budgets. When you say crop budget, what do you buy? The cost of inputs you use, the labor, and other things put together, that is the crop budget. That's the production cost. And that becomes the basis for the calculation of his sum insured. So this is how it happens. The difference between this product and the commercial one, that the multiple commercial, is that here the farmer doesn't come looking for the insurance company for a claim.
Okay.
But what happens is that at the end of the season, because during the season, data will be shared with the farmer.
Right.
So at the end of the season, we go and sit with him and say, okay, for the periodic measurements, at the period of 3 months that your crop was on the field, this were the pattern of the rainfall, and there was a shortfall of this, so this is what we have to pay you. Then we make what we call a payout. Then we have another product. But drought is not the only challenge of the farmers.
Right.
We have excess rainfall, we have outbreak of disease, like what we have, and pests, like what we have for anywhere,
yes,
in 2017.
Yes.
So in that situation, we also look at the yield. What affect the yield? But in this particular one, the area yield, we look at the yield in the districts. So first, we take the historical data of the district, and let's say the average yield in the district is, let's say, for maize, is, let's say, 1 ton per acre. That becomes the standard. Then we give you a guarantee of, let's say, 80%. So you have 0.8 tons per acre. So that will be the standard, which if you get to that level, then you are okay. But anything below that, due to any of the insurable risks, like drought, excess rainfall, or outbreak of disease in the district, not on a particular farmer's farm,
right,
in the district,
okay,
so which has lower...
That will affect all the other farmers.
Exactly, or majority,
right,
of them, depending on their location,
okay,
in the district. So the, and that will lower the yield in the district. So assuming at the end of the season, the yield for the district is less than 0.5. So we are selling 0.8. And about 0.5, so there's a shortfall of 0.3 metric tons. And then the cost of ton, if you are using the farmer's crop budget, let's say you use 1,000 cedis per acre for it to produce a ton, that means 0.3 of 1,000 cedis, which is 300 cedis. So every farmer with 1 acre in that district will get 300 cedis. If, let's say, you have 2 acres times 2, you have 4 acres times 2.
Okay.
That's how
the calculation is done.
It's done.
Okay.
Exactly.
Right. How are you measuring the success of what MOFA is supposed to do on behalf of the insurance company. Then you said you set a secretariat. Do you have it in all the regions or just a few for now?
The secretariat mentioned is something we have in the policy we are developing.
Okay.
It's not something that has been put on the ground yet.
Right.
But what we normally do is that for every region that we travel to, we try to liaise with the regional directors of MOFA. And most of the programs, at times, they even invite us to join some of the programs so that we can educate farmers on agriculture insurance.
Now, since you mentioned that you mostly deal with groups and not individuals, how are you ensuring or urging farmers to put themselves together in groups? Because I have traveled to a few of the regions already. I've met a few of the farmers. Each time we find out, do you have association? They said no. Why? They don't have a reason. So how are you putting or urging them on to put themselves in groups to be able to benefit from this policy?
Thank you very much for that question. I think that's one of the setbacks of the Ghanaian farming system. You know, when you go to places like Rwanda, for instance, they have cooperatives. And the cooperatives are not just on paper. They are up and doing, they're working. They have National Cooperative Regulators Association, which regulates them. They have executives at all times. But that's one of the setbacks for the distribution of inputs, and agriculture insurance is not an exception, to smallholder farmers. Because, as I mentioned earlier, it won't be a business case for me to travel from here to Garu or to move to see 1 acre or 2 acre and come back.
Okay.
It's not a business case. But if you are in a group, association of, let's say, 1,000 farmers, at least it's easy to reach out to them. So this is one of the challenges we have. And another issue is that they have NGOs that are farmer-based organizations. But more often than not, these farmer-based organizations are formed around projects. A project comes and they gather the farmers. And at the end of the project, you don't see them as an association. So that's one of the challenges we go through. So alternatively, what we try to do is to see, let's say, a processor who is doing agro-war system. And agro-war system meaning he has supplied inputs to farmers. Let's say about 1,000 or 2,000 or 4,000 farmers where he gives the inputs and take their produce in kind to feed his factory. So we talk to such people and partner with them and add insurance to the inputs they are giving to the farmers. So in that situation, if there are 4,000 farmers, we can readily reach out to 4,000 farmers.
Okay.
We've done that with companies like Premium Foods, AgriCare in the past. Currently this year, we are partnering with Kita, that's the Kumasi Institute of Tropical Agriculture. We have IDAN, Agro IDAN in Tamale. We have about 6 companies we identified this year, which we are partnering with, and they are over 10,000 farmers.
My next question has to do with the premium.
Okay.
Is the premium dependent on the type of crop or animal, and what is the highest premium that a commercial and smallholder farmer is expected to pay?
Thank you very much for your question. I think the determination of the premium is basically based on the farm practice we are having and the kind of product we are giving. And again, some are crop-specific.
Okay.
Because the nature or physiology of the crops are not the same. For example, somebody doing maize and is opting for drought alone is different from somebody doing maize and opting for area yield index insurance. So those are the differences.
Okay.
Then a commercial farmer doing maize, that's 1,000 hectares of maize. His risk profile will bring his weight to a different level than the one we have for the smaller farmers. So what we have is that we normally give a special for the commercial farmers. And when I talk of commercial farmers, I definitely that for 50 hectares and above.
And above, that's a commercial farmer.
And in that case, we have to know the quality of the personnel managing the place, then his farm management, then his protocols, the inputs, the planting. Is he going to use a planter to plant or is he going to use human medicine to plant? If you're using a planter, you see the plant population will be different from just spacing them anyhow. So all these are some of the assessments we do before we can add the risk he's taking. For example, I'm a commercial farmer, I'm doing irrigation. So I'll tell you I don't need drought. Okay, fine. So that I need not to charge him for drought. So we normally give a range between 3% and 5% for the commercial farmers. And in that case, when we do the assessment, you fall in between. Then when it comes to the smallholder farmers, because we don't visit their farms, their product is generic. If it's drought, drought for everybody. If it's area yield, drought, excess rainfall, and maybe outbreak of disease for everybody. Unlike the commercial
farmers. So these three items are combined
together and charge you. So anyone that will care to bring a loss to the yield, you'll be compensated.
Okay. My farmers, they are very particular. I don't know. You didn't ask him, is it 500 cedis? Is it 1,000 Ghana cedis? 200? Let's mention that specific for them.
That will not come from us. It comes from the farmer.
Okay.
It comes from the farmer because there are different ways we try to assess the total sum insured, as I mentioned earlier. For example, if I'm using my production cost, and let's say I choose that to produce a ton of maize, I use 1,000 cedis
to produce
1,000 tons of maize. So that is what I'm going to use. And maybe I have 2 tons per hectare or 5 tons per hectare. That's where the basis will be. Then when there's a compensation, I'm also going to pay based on your production cost. But some will say, no, I want to add my margins to use the sales value. Maize is, let's say, 1,500 Ghana. I'm using hypothetical figures. 1,500 Ghana cedis per ton.
Okay.
So use that in my calculation. So his sum insured will be different from the one using the production costs.
Okay.
Then there's another third way. I'm taking a facility from the bank.
Okay.
So I want to link my insurance to the facility I'm taking.
Okay.
So we have to break the facility to give the cost per ton in that.
Okay.
So when there's a loss,
you
can
how to.
Exactly. Okay. About. So these are the three methods
right.
The farmers are exposed to use in determining their sum insured.
Interesting and an exciting conversation right here in the office of Ghana Agricultural Insurance Pool with the general manager, Alhaji Ali Muhammad Petu. He's explaining what this whole insurance pool business is all about and why, if you are not part of it yet, you should put yourself together and invite them to your region. My name is Senyuna and you're watching The Ghanaian Farmer. Coming up in 60 seconds on a break. And when I come back, we'll wrap up on the conversation. Stay tuned, I'll be right back. Tomato mix. If you're cooking home, you are a lady, you are a bachelor, and you've gone to the market to shop, remember to buy Lizzy Tomato mix. If you want to be a distributor, you can equally contact them on the numbers displayed on the screen. Go on our social media platform, Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, and YouTube, The Ghanaian Farmer. Share your views with us. What are some questions you want to ask Mr. Ketu? Probably I might not ask it here, but if you ask me, I could always share with you to come through with a response for me. And don't forget that on the 27th of this month, Ghanaian Farmer, in partnership with Joy Business, we are presenting the Ghanaian Farmer Conference 2021. And the theme is the role of stakeholders in solving agricultural development challenges along the value chain. We have a lot of speakers passing through. We are expecting the Ghana Commodity Exchange CEO. We are expecting a lot more CEO. The Buffer Stock CEO will be passing through. The Crop Research Institute. And of course, Mr. Ketu would also be passing through. You should be there to share what your challenges are and how best we can address those challenges. My name is Enyuna, and today's conversation is all about the Ghana Agriculture Insurance Pool and what you need to know about them. So, I'll add it back to you. Now, let's quickly move. You've mentioned the kind of incident that your insurance cover. Now, let's move to how easy or difficult is it for farmers to have their produce insured you know, when they need be. How difficult is that?
That's a very good question. The difficulty will come for the farmers assessing the products. One, like you said, you travel along and go to a community when they are not in an association, and they are small other farmers. So definitely, they won't fall on my radar. They won't be able to assess them. But even the group, it's easy for us to reach out to them. And some of them, they are NGO-related farmer associations. We just work with them, and all the farmers will be insured. And like the partners I gave Mukita, which is an institution, Kumasi, Kumasi is of tropical agriculture. They support farmers, give them inputs and that. And we have people like Hope Line, who is also in the rice sector. They organize rice farmers and other to be partner with them, and through them can get this. So the easiest way to get insurance is coming together and let's work with you. Because individually, we don't deal with individuals. But if they are commercial farmers, fine, they come straight
away. Okay, commercial farmers are critical. But the smallholder farmers,
that doesn't mean the proof, exactly. Okay. Or if they are applying for a loan from a bank, they can use the bank and we'll have discussion with them. And in most cases, what we do is that we make the bank the first loss payee. Mm-hmm. So when there's a loss, it's paid through the bank before it gets to the farmers.
Oh, I see.
So that's how it works.
That's interesting. Only to the fact that most mainline insurance companies avoid the agri sector due to various uncertainties. How has it been your motivation to stay in line with businesses for a decade and counting?
Thank you very much for that question. You know, those of us in the financial services sector, you all perceive agri as a high risk area.
Exactly.
It's only insurance. The banks don't lend to agriculture. If you check the lending to commercial lending to, I mean, the country, only 3.7% goes into agriculture. I mean, when you break it further to production, it's lower because of the rate of natural disasters, which are always beyond the farmers control. Some are climatic and non-climatic challenges. So this is why we have the mainline insurance not going. But GAIF was set up specifically to do that job, to provide agriculture insurance products for the farming community. So when you take the farming chain, the warehousing, we don't go there.
Okay.
The transport center, we don't go there. Processing, we are not there. But when it comes to production, that is where agri insurance finds itself. So we have the expertise to deal with the natural disasters and everything. And like I explained to you, we have to assess if it's a commercial farmer, do your risk profile, and give you the appropriate premium to pay. And this is one of the challenges we also face, and it's also reflected in our patronage, because the premium rates are higher as compared to the normal or traditional insurance. Why? Because the rate we are taking, well, premium is always commensurate with the rate that we're taking. And the rate we take is beyond the farmer's control. What someone may call act of God. If there's drought, and I mean, the farmer cannot do anything about it. If there's excess rainfall, for example, we have some years that the rainfall continues for a whole week. And if your farm is in a low-lying area, before you go to attend to a fish pond, your crops are just
swimming
in the,
right.
the exactly. And beyond the farmer's control, what dredging can the farmer do, or whatever can do to, I mean, draw all this water from the stream. So it's beyond his control.
Okay.
Take the four amine that came. I mean, due to the Ghanaian farmers, they were using detergents to fight four amine. Can you imagine that? So this is where we come in. So anything that's beyond the farmer's control. So we were set up to provide sustainable and innovative product for that sector of the value chain. So that is our specialty.
You did make mention that you have engaged insurance companies or executives to now sell the Ghana's agricultural insurance product. However, apart from that, what other means are you adopting or considering to adopt to make yourself more visible, to make your benefit more laudable in the ears of farmers to patronize your services?
Thank you very much. Ideally, that's what GAIF was set up for, that we will only develop the products and the insurance companies will market it.
Right.
But because of its nature and speciality, I mean, most insurance companies don't go in there. So that is why we also added the marketing, the distribution, everything to the front. So we do the underwriting on behalf of the pool. We do the reinsurance. We do loss assessment, claim payment, everything on their behalf. So this is how it is. So it's a specialized area. That's one, like you said earlier. No, you can't just jump in and do that. For example, if you are a great insurance underwriter, you should have a knowledge of agronomy. Because if you go to the field and you should know the plant population, who can give you the yield that the farmer claims he's going to get? He's using the potential of the seed, but the conditions when they make that seed have that potential, is it the same thing you are seeing on the field? So if you don't know all these things, yes, you do the underwriting, give the policy, the next thing is a claim. Because the situation on the ground cannot support that output, and you have guaranteed that. So this is where it's a difficult area, it's a specialized area, so you need to. But because it's our job, we are trained to do that, it's easier for us to assess. And in some cases, we even advise some of the farmers. I remember a particular farmer, we visited his farm, and he was a commercial farmer for that matter. The blocks that he was creating was so huge. So we advised that, why don't you break it into smaller units? Because if you have a supervisor going around, he will just walk around the peripheries and leave the inner part. And if there's any challenge in the inner part, he may not bring that to your attention. And it's these days that we are using drones to oversight fields. But in the past, you have to walk around it or something like that. And he took our advice. And then the following year, he just made them into a smaller units, which is easier for, because the commercial farmers, they farm in blocks. You see? So at times we advise. There was a poultry farmer we engaged. And when we got there, but what we saw on the field could not allow us to insure. For example, if I should insure this building, when I come here, I should see fire extinguisher and other things in place. So in case there's fire, you minimize the loss that will get. If you don't have it, I'll recommend it for you. And you put that in place before I put you on cover.
Okay.
So because that you are taking risks, it doesn't mean you go and take anything.
Okay. Okay. We are not running up our interview, even though I know you have a lot to say. But we'll plan for another day. However, Amadi, on a general level, insurance is even finding it difficult to penetrate in our country, to convince people to insure their properties, life, and all that. Now, if your mother, or what if they are your fathers, they are finding it difficult to penetrate with all the benefit that comes along. Are we going to see a different story with Ghana's agriculture insurance board?
Thank you very much. I think we should see a different picture, but currently I will assure you that the picture is not different. The picture is the same. Because even those of us in the urban areas, maybe if you only got to know about insurance when you bought your first car, without the car, you didn't know. And because of the policeman on the road, you run to come and do insurance. You wait for insurance to come and look for you. But when you come to have insurance, it's not like that. So that is why in most cases, the advanced countries, both developed and underdeveloped economies, they try to bundle agriculture insurance with what the farmer needs. For example, the farmer needs credit. So the banker makes insurance as a requirement. Let me give you an example. If I go to any bank now to take a personal loan, there's insurance attached. They don't have to go and bring insurance. But they have an arrangement with a life insurance company who will cover the facility for that period. So in case the man drops off within the period, they don't fall on the survivors for the outstanding balance, but rather they go to the insurance. Auto loan, they even request for comprehensive insurance. You see? So if the bank make it that money, okay, if I going to want me to give you a loan for your farming, the farmer is insured. That's one area we can increase the penetration. Then input suppliers, like the agrovers scheme I mentioned about, or even in-grower scheme. When you talk about in-grower scheme, that means the farmer has his own land about 500 acres and he give it to 500 farmers, 1 acre each. That's the block farming. So in this situation, he will add insurance, whatever input is given to the farmer. And that's the only way it will penetrate. Other than that, and that is what we are trying to do with the new, insurance policy, which is under being developed through the support of AGRA.
Okay.
And let me mention that Ghana will be among the first of African countries who have put up a policy of that nature together, because travel along, I mean, Africa, we don't have it. So, and what the college is trying to do is set up the role of each stakeholder. The NIC, exactly. The NIC, which is the regulator of insurance, has its role. The financial institutions, MOFA, as you mentioned, will have its role to play. Then we have the insurance companies, the farmer associations, and farmer reps, and all those ones. Everybody will know what to do. And that will help to promote agriculture insurance. So the policy is trying to look at it from a different angle. Because the problem you raise is rare, it's there. And it shows 10 years we are not known, 10 years uptake is low, 10 years patronage is very low. So the story is not different. But we are looking at another way of trying to push it. And if planting for food and jobs, for example, has insurance component attached, how many farmers will benefit from insurance? Agri insurance? A lot. We have rare for food and this thing. Then we have planning for export and I mean, all these projects
right.
should have agri insurance. Then the development partners, because we have developed partners doing a lot in the agri production sector, trying to get the farmers to adapt. Okay. And what we are trying to do is the farmers should be able to use it through this medium, and they see the benefits they derive from it. There will be a time, if I walk to a shop and I buy a product, it's good for me. Nobody tells me to go and buy the second one. You know, the insurance. It's governed by law, and it was at 72 for the insurance law of 2006, which has been amended, and the last parliament passed it before they has, I mean, it was dissolved. And that's the insurance law 2020, which has been accepted by the president. In that law, we have provision for the subject of agriculture insurance fund. And one of the key things that fund is supposed to do is to push in farmers by way of giving them some premium support. So that, as I mentioned, premium rates are high, but if the premium support comes, at least to pushing you, if you're supposed to pay 10 cities and pay or 5 cities, at least it will also motivate you. And that will also help us so that the financial institutions can also lend more to agriculture. No, the other institutions giving guarantees to the banks, but the farmers should also need to be protected. But if I'm walking to go and take a facility and my farm gets burnt or my farm gets through drought, and I still have to go and pay the facility, where do I get another source of funds to pay? So that's the essence of insurance, and that's the message we want to put across.
Right, so thank you very much. You heard it all from the General Manager of Ghana Agriculture Insurance Pool. His name is Alhadi Ali Muhammad Ketu. Ketu, we thank you so much for having us in your office, but I think this is a very clear message to all the farmers, especially to the farmers that have been calling me every now and then about challenges they are facing in their various districts or regions. Please, you have to find a way to form an association. They don't deal with individuals, but they deal with associations. But it's different for commercial farmers. So find a way to link up with this institution for the greater good of everybody. My name is Enyonam. And next week, we'll come your way with another insightful conversation. But for now, thanks so much for watching. We'll see you once again. Bye-bye.